the complete 4 or 5 days to learn that. So let's begin with the my thought process and the some of the ideas which can connect you at the right place at the right pitch to the blockchain technology. This has been considered as the most disruptive technology in last few decades, and that's what's the important it carries. So with this, let's go at the very basic, what world expects today. So the world expects is seamless and ubiquitous intelligence through immersive experience, through connected physical to physical, virtual to virtual, physical to virtual, and virtual to physical world actually. So world is expecting this, that whether I am working with the physical world or I am working with the virtual world or any combinations, I should have a very seamless, intelligent, ubiquitous, and immersive experience. And as we see that when the some of the childs or kids are playing the games, they feel that that is the real world. So that type of the integration, that type of the experience, the real world is expecting out of the technology today. And under the umbrella of this expectation, under the umbrella of this dimension, let's see how the blockchain technology is going to help or the blockchain technology is going to contribute. DARQ is an acronym, which is the word which is referring today. So D is basically DLT, that is digital distributed ledger technology. A is artificial intelligence, that is machine learning, deep learning. R is reality, that is augmented reality, virtual reality, hybrid reality. And Q is the quantum computing. And we can have the E as my endpoint computing if we really want to add. And a cloud is really the backbone for all this technology. That's what is the baseline understanding prevails in the world. But 2025 is going to be ruled by dark. That's what the world is talking all about. Let's go to the basics. What science knows, we really need to follow. How much science you know is really the challenge. The flow or the seamless flow of the data is expected from device to data center. So data center is nothing but the my physical hosting of my cloud. And there was a time when the network is computer was the slogan. Today the slogan is cloud is the computer. So there has been a huge shift in terms of the thinking, in terms of the ideology, in terms of the technology. So everybody's into the digital transformation. And the digital transformation is talking about the digital privacy and the credibility of the data. So data has become the fundamental base. My digital enterprise, whether we consider data is a new oil or we really want to go database, sorry, data-driven decision, then what is the technology that is going to help me? And in particularly when we are talking about the connected vehicles, we are talking about the automated vehicles where human intervention is not there or human is not there in the vehicle like autonomous drone. We have a very different type of the city, smart city. So with all this, how the blockchain is going to play the role that we are going to touch upon. If anybody has any question, I suggest that please feel free to ask me at that moment only, and let's have a very interactive session. So it would really fetch more value for everybody. So blockchain technology, distributed ledger, it is also considered as a notarized ledger. It is also considered as a triple accounting system. Value exchange protocol, decentralized technology, all such synonym or the addendums are used along with the blockchain technology. When we say notarized ledger, why notarized ledger? Because if I have prepared some ledger and if somebody has to validate it, then we need a official person like a notary who has to endorse that, yes, this is correct. But here there is no such need. Everything is self-sufficient. That technology is such that you really don't need the third party for endorsing it. Everybody knows about the journey of the financial accounting from single entry to the double entry. Now, this blockchain technology is really applying the concept of the triple entry accounting. So there are not one account, two account, but more than two accounts which are being added and the transactions are being taken care. So once again, you really don't need the any third party to endorse whether your transactions are correct or not. Everybody knows that in 2009, it started with the Bitcoin. And at that time, nobody was aware of the blockchain as a technology or the backbone or the peer-to-peer capability technology or other thing. So it started with money. So let's try to connect with money and then we go further how the blockchain is connected and why it has become so popular. So money, what it can offer you? So money can store the wealth for you and it can store your savings and you are becoming capable to make the transactions. That's what the money really, really offers. So history has been, there was a time when there was barter. I give you something and you give me something and transaction used to be completed. And it was a very mutual one. Someone will give a bulk of rice and somebody may give a bulk of wheat and mutual exchange may happen. After that, actually coin came in. So there were metal coin, there were even leather coin, and coin had its own problem and challenges, which ultimately led to a paper currency. So which we all are using today. There are different school of thought which says that after paper currency, there was a plastic money, which is nothing but the credit card. There are people who are saying that there is online money, which we are doing through net banking or the e-commerce related transactions I am doing. And in the whole journey, the cryptocurrency has been added into the list. And that's what we are going to touch upon. World or industry has moved from the three layer actually, or it is at the third layer, that there was a theism where everybody used to trust the God. Then came it said, no, everything is done by the humanism, humans. So humanism came in picture. So, but humanism identified that it is nothing but the mistakes. And third thing is dataism, that is the trust data. And that's how we are considering today the data-driven decision related world or the organizations or the institutes or the industry. So with this cryptocurrency, there are different thought process in the world which is going on. It is a very different type of the anatomy or the terminology, I can say, that is internet of money. And I'm sure very rarely you would have come across this particular terminology. Internet of money, it's a huge subject and it gives a huge opportunity for the candidates who are really interested in doing the research in this domain. Anyway, coming back to the cryptocurrency part, different school of thought are giving a different nomenclature to this particular currency. That is, someone says that it is a paperless currency. Someone says that it is a virtual currency. Someone is saying that, no, it's an alternate currency. There are people who say that, no, it's not currency at all. it's a digital asset. There is a school of thought which is saying that this is commodity. Other side of people are saying, you know, this is one more medium of barter. Another school says that, no, it's money but not a currency. Someone is saying it's goods. So these are not the terminology for the sake of the terminology. In the world, different country, different people are believing different things. And to an extent that if any country believe that this is a commodity or this is a goods, then they are charging the tax on the cryptocurrency which are prevailing on the goods in that country. So these are not some fancy idea, or these are not the fancy term, or these are not just an academic terms which are being used for the cryptocurrency per se. So there is a definitely back-to-back connect, and a respective execution is also getting implemented into the respective currency, into the respective country. Why we should give importance or value or weightage to the cryptocurrency? Let's go here and look at the few statistics. That in the whole world, it is currently considered that there are 200 trillion paper money plus gold exist. That's what is the estimation. Now, cryptocurrency capitalization has gone to $400 billion, and it's going to touch soon $1 trillion capitalization. So it's a huge number, and not possible to ignore. We also cannot say that I don't know, so I will not be able to use that. No one is saying that on the road every day so many accidents are happening, so I will not drive the vehicle, or I will not use the vehicle. Or there are so many train accidents, so I will not travel in the train. No, that's not the case. You really need to understand that how to make sure that you leverage it the most, how to make sure that you don't get adversely affected by that. What are the precautions that you are needing or you will require? All those things will put to all of you on the right track or the right understanding. I have written certain names here, and I have put some numbers also, which is bit 1 year old, but it's huge, so I have retained that numbers only. That Bitcoin, Ethereum, XRP, Bitcoin Cash, Tether, Litecoin, EOS, Binance Coin, all these things, Stellar, all these things are amongst the top 10 cryptocurrency. And capitalization has happened in the range of the $200 billion, which itself is very, very huge, actually. So it's important. That's what I'm saying. And nobody will be able to ignore it. Only you have to think that how we can utilize this. I'll take you to this particular slide in a connect. That in the whole world today, there are two different schools, but one is saying that there are approximately 7,000 different cryptocurrency exist in the world today. The other are saying that it is approximately 4,600. Nonetheless, both the numbers are very, very huge, and it's not going to be possible even to know that what are the names. Now I will like to connect here that in the world, let's say there are 250 countries, then there can be only 250 currency only. There may be one or two more, like euro as a currency, but we are not going to exceed 250 currency, physical currency or the paper currency in the world. While here in the cryptocurrency, we have almost 5,000 cryptocurrency to manage. So it's a huge number. wide variety. Everybody has their own perspective, and here the statistics are available that in 1 year, from $194 billion, it has reached to the $325 billion. So capitalization has increased substantially. If we see it, it is almost like $125 billion capitalization has increased in 1 year in cryptocurrency. And that's what is the strength, that's what is the power of the cryptocurrency I would like to portray in front of you. And cryptocurrency is backed by the blockchain technology. So all of you would have realized and would have connect by now that what is the level of the blockchain technology, or the maturity level of the blockchain technology, has increased in one last decade, that is 2009 to till date, is tremendous. So like BSE, that is Bombay Stock Exchange, or like NSE, and there are indexes like Sensex and the Nifty. Same before the cryptocurrency, there are different index available in the world, and that is CIC 30 and CRIX. These are the two most respectable, renowned indexes are there, and they declare every day in real time that how many transactions are going on in this market, and what is the rate of the currency and whatnot. There has been a trend that vertical specific currency, or the industry specific currency. So the industry specific currency means oil sector people, they've identified their own one currency, and they will do the all transactions into the that particular currency only. Even dental people have identified such currency. Photography sector has identified such currency. And vertical specific currency exists. Up till now, we can say that geography specific currency was there, and now we are talking about the industry specific currency. So there is a complete change in terms of the thought process. If we go and extrapolate that what's going to happen in 2025, which is considered as a very milestone year, and we refer to the technology DARQ, which reference to 2025 itself. So here we are saying that 10% of the global GDP value would be in the blockchain technology. So that is a huge number, and nobody will be able to live without it, or nobody will be able to bypass it actually. The cryptography is at the one of the technology which is at the base, and the SHA-56, Scrape, Carptonite, NeoScript, all these things have been the one of the most popular cryptography algorithms which were used for the different activities, or into the different cryptocurrency formation. So here it gives, you can look at the chart that the number of transactions which are happening per day. So basically in this unregulated economy, few lakhs transactions are being carried out every day. This indicates that volume, it is just at the beginning of this calendar year, that what is the everyday volume. So in terms of the volume, these are the different exchanges. We'll touch what are the exchanges and other things on, but these are the exchanges. There are more than one cryptocurrency exchanges available in the world, and these are the top 10 you can consider. And in 30 days, every cryptocurrency exchange is doing the business of almost $40 billion every day, average. So it means every exchange is doing the business of more than $1 billion per day. And if we go by this top 10 exchange, then it is more than $10 billion every day by these top 10 exchanges. So you can imagine, you can connect, you can create a value for this, that how much is relevant, how much is important. So breakup is something like this. Graph is on the screen, and you can connect the which particular cryptocurrency is accounting for how much billion US dollar capitalization as of now. Or this may be little old figure, few months, but these are fairly good number to accept that yes, this is the reality or this is the current scenario. So you can connect that Bitcoin and Ethereum are the most two popular cryptocurrency or the ultimately platforms in the domain of the blockchain. There are others, but they are more focused on the cryptocurrency part. Ethereum has emerged as an open source platform for the crypto dimensions. So I was referring the crypto exchanges. So you can see that there are more than 500 crypto exchanges exist in the world, and 250 plus are running into the commercial stage. So that's how the so many number of transactions are happening every day. There are 19,000 different trading pairs. When we say trading pair means I want to convert USD to Bitcoin, or I want to convert XRP cryptocurrency to Ethereum. So any such permutation combination. So there are such 19,000 trading pair combinations are available into the crypto exchange. Each exchange may not be offering all such permutation combination, but all put together, we are really getting such 19,000 trading pair. Like if I have to consider that, if I have to give the analogy, that BSE, how many trading pair? Once again, we can come out with huge number that from Reliance, I want to sell and I want to purchase the, let's say, Tata share. So such things, you can have an analogy or you can connect. ATM. More than 7,000 ATM exist in the world today, or cryptocurrency ATM in particular. And every day, 11 or more cryptocurrency ATM are being installed. So the numbers are continuously increasing, and anybody can go to the ATM and can do the transaction. See your cryptocurrency, the way in which you are doing with your normal financial transaction for the INR or the dollar or whatever it may be currency. Same thing here on this ATM, one can have the cryptocurrency related transactions. So we can have a kiosk also, we can have a ATM also in case of the Bitcoin. Bitcoin is offering the two types of the medium through which we can really carry out the exchange. But would like to draw your attention on the screen on the almost last line that they are really charging very high, and 7% is being charged for the exchanges. So it's not cheap, I would like to say. It is going to ask for a lot of money. So it is not for my day-to-day or common transactions. That's what I would like to give a hint to you. It is not the blockchain alone in the technology, but today blockchain and AI, blockchain and IoT, blockchain and big data, everything is getting connected. On the other hand, the blockchain technology market size 2015 to 2025 in terms of the US million USD million is ported here in the chart, and three categorization has been done, that what would be on the public cloud, what would be on the private cloud, and what would be on the hybrid cloud. Blockchain is not an isolated technology. I would like to just connect only on one part, that if I want to combine the data of my blockchain and RDBMS, that is very much possible. SAP is offering a platform through which you can store the data into the blockchain. You can have the SAP HANA database. You fetch the data from both the respective technology. One is the RDBMS technology and other is the blockchain technology. And then you create your own dashboard, and you can create the new type of the information system which really world expects or world is really looking for. And that's how growth rate is very, very high, in the range of the 69.4% CAGR from 2019 to 2025. So let's see what Gartner is saying. Everybody, I'm sure, will be aware that Gartner is trusted as the most respected analyst in the world in the domain of the information technology. And there are so many things on the screen that what Gartner is saying, that authenticated provenance, managed services, decentralized web, smart contract, post-quantum blockchain, ledger DBMS, zero knowledge proofs, blockchain and IoT, blockchain for data security, blockchain for platform as a service, all these things are on the rise. And on the other side, which is on the peak actually, so some of the consensus mechanism, security, smart contracts, decentralized identity, tokenization, interoperability of the blockchain. So all these topics are at the peak, and huge activity in terms of the technology is going on. I would like to check whether anybody has any question or any curiosity further on whatever I have discussed up till now.
Sir, can we keep this question answer session at the end?
Okay, fine, no problem.
If any participant is having any query as of now, they can ask. No issues.
Okay, fine. So let's keep last 15 minutes for question answer. So I'll continue in terms of the slide which is there on the screen. In 2023, 2 trillion of the goods and service annually will be managed by the blockchain. Here, if we see dimensions of the blockchain, encryption, immutability, tokenization, decentralization, distribution. I'm sure so many terminologies, some of the terminologies would be very, very new. So those terminologies, all of you should note it down, and you have to make sure in all your subsequent session of your FTP, you learn that technology, you understand that technology, and you really connect with the world, where the world is really running in and moving ahead in terms of the blockchain as a technology. So the majority which is being expected in 2025 in the blockchain is like from enabling to inspired to the complete to the enhanced blockchain. That's what the journey blockchain is going to traverse, as per the Gartner, whatever official sources I have reflected here, so everybody can connect on that. This is very interesting hype cycle. I will keep this slide for a little more time. You should read each and everything which is written here. And this will give the connect that, okay, from where it has gone, where, and ultimately it's heading towards the, which this is once again a 1 year old slide, I have not come across the any new slide of 2020. So I have to retain this 2019's. But this is also very, very indicative and which is very close to reality. This also gives you certain idea that which are the domains or which are the industries or which are the verticals they have already tried the or they have already explored the blockchain. So some of the things which are coming here is very, very eye-catching, like advertising industry has tried this, or the salespeople has tried this for the blockchain, the lead management, the oil and gas industry, retail, media, the smart asset, the supply chain, logistics, so many domains have explored and utilized the capabilities of the blockchain technology. Here comes the interesting part, that what are the number of patents that has happened every year. So you can see that 2008, 9, 10, the number of patents has increased. In 2019, actually, the number of patents were 7,000. I have a complete list available. That what are the patents that has been registered from 1st January 2019 to 31st December. And I can show you it on the screen also. Just allow me a minute and I will be able to open up. Yeah, Excel is open. Let me share the Excel. Yeah, is my Excel screen visible now?
Not yet, sir. Oh. Yeah, now it is available, sir.
Yeah, okay, fine. So there is some delay. Okay, thanks. Yeah, see, now I will take you to the last. There are more than 7,000. Yeah, but there is some data related to first 10 days of the 2020s also included in this. So roughly 7,000 patent has been registered, and I can scroll through you because it not become possible for you to read, but just to give a connect that what is the amount of the research, what is the amount of the work which is really going on, and if anybody is interested in doing any research or any patent related activity into the domain of the blockchain and they want any such data, feel free to contact me. I'll be able to help you. So that's what I can say. And with this, I can go back to my previous screen, or I can go on scrolling this, because if somebody has to read this, then this itself is like a one book. So you will require to read the book of some 200, 300 pages. That much content is there in this Excel. So it would be very difficult. So would go back and connect to the our original presentation. I'm going back to my PPT. Yeah, so we have more than 7,000 or almost 7,000 patent registered on the blockchain domain only in US in 2019. So let's see which are the companies which are really holding the good amount of the patent and how they are progressing actually. So IBM, Intel, MasterCard, Delaware National Association, Visa, British Telecommunication, Microsoft, Accenture, so many companies are holding so many number of the patents that you can see in terms of the chart actually. In the US, there were 5,000 registrations. In the US has done almost 5,000, China has done almost 1,500. If you go down, India is nowhere. See, it's all of you have to do a huge work. All of you should go and try to do something in this particular technology as well, so that we India earn few number of patents at least, and we can have a good entry or good foray in the domain of the technology. That's what I can suggest you. I can request you that all of you should do something related to the patent in this, because India is nowhere in the list, even in few hundred, while US and China are having few thousand. That's what is the difference that we really need to bridge in terms of this technology. These are the startup related numbers. I don't have the data for 2019 and 20, but there has been a very good trend in last 5 years to start the startup into the blockchain related technology, and those are really high, because and 2017 was peak where more than 700, almost 800 got registered, but otherwise 300 has been a very standard number in last 5 years to get registered. So every year the 300 startups are getting registered. It means if we go by the working day average, then it is one per day, which is phenomenal, if I have to use the word, in terms of the startup being registered. Every day one startup for blockchain, huge. This is country-wise breakup, that in which country, how many blockchain-related startups has been founded. So US is once again leader, but then the Britain, Canada. Hello? Am I audible? I'm not able to listen anything. Hello?
Yes, sir, you're audible.
Okay, because I'm getting some noise or some voice, so I'm not able to connect actually.
Yes, yeah. Please continue, sir.
Yeah, thank you. So Singapore, India here is somewhere in number that 71 blockchain related startup or the companies were founded in the India, and today the number has increased, and in particularly the South, I would like to say, and mostly in Chennai, the blockchain related activity is very high. And if I remember it correctly, I don't know the which state, I don't remember the name of the state, but very first blockchain university of the India was started, I believe, at least 2 years before. So that's the pace at which the South is moving into the, or the Southern India is moving in the blockchain technology. Uh, As we are continuing on the research, these are considered as some of the most important topics of the research, that which are the topics where there is a scope for the research can be carried out. So you, all of you can go through this screen. This is very simple. You can read and understand. There is so if you have any specific segment of your interest or any specific area of your current research or the prospective research, you may note it down and you may start exploring it. Or if some of the topic is very appealing to you, you may start learning that topic and can do the some research in that, and you may earn even your PhD into this domain, or you can file your patent if you are going to be passionate about the any of this subject. So
hello.
Yeah.
Sir, sorry for interruption. Sir, many of the participants are asking that what are the major driving force behind all these applications? What is there in blockchain which helps each and every domain to adopt it so properly? Can you please share some? Okay.
Yeah, we'll definitely tell. Okay, so blockchain is a technology is offering two fundamental things, and these two fundamental things are, if once I have committed a transaction, nobody can change that transaction. That is the first thing, because when we say blockchain means there are continuously blocks written in a sequential manner, and those blocks are getting appended at the end only. Nobody can go and write the block in between. That is one. And the whole technology has been devised in such a way that the nobody can change the data of the previous block. How they are not able to write the data of the previous block, I'll explain. Whenever I write the data and my one block is over, let's say technically my block, for simplicity I'm saying that my block is of 4K. So I'm writing the data of, sorry, 4MB, that my block is of 4MB. So as soon as my 4MB data is over, I will create a new block. Now, whenever I create a new block, let's say this was my first block, then I'm creating a next block. So when I'm writing the next block, what I will do, or the technology is doing, that it is generating a hash value of all the content put together of the block one, and it writes that hash value into the block two. Hello?
Yes, sir.
Should I continue? I'm getting some noise, so I just halted.
Yes, sir, you can continue.
Yeah, so it will write the hash value in the block two. Now, if I go and try to modify something in the block number one, it will not match the hash value which is already written in the block number two. Now, if I continue, and let's say that we have reached to the block number 25. So my block number 25 has hash value of the block number 24's content. And I cannot go back and change the block number three, because in that case I have to change the hash value of each and every block, and when I return hundreds of blocks, thousands of the block, it's not possible in the given time to change that value. That is one. Continuously new blocks are getting added, so that's how also it is not becoming possible to go and change the value in the previous block. Second part, it is also encrypted. The third part, typically into the current RDBMS, you might have seen that my data is only on the one server, or at the most I have a HA server and it is there on the two server. But in case of the blockchain, there are multiple servers. It can be 50, it can be 100. So everyone who is mining the block will have the complete replica of my complete blockchain. So even if, let's say, theoretically it's not possible, but I'm saying hypothetically that changing the value on the one server or the one blockchain node, there would be another 50 nodes which will be having a correct value. So they will not accept it. And as a result, all 50 will have the same data, same value, everything. So even though there is no central agency, the technology is such that which is getting replicated, or the data all across, and not only replicated, whenever a one block is to be created, technology asks to its all the existing nodes or the active node to be very precise, that should I add this block? And if they say okay, then only the new block is getting added, and as soon as the block is added, that block will get reflected or will get updated into the blockchain of the all the servers which are active. And whichever servers are not active, whenever they go live, the point where they went offline till the time, all the blockchain data or the new blocks which have been added will get updated, and then only the offline node which has become online now can participate or can transact. That is the basic capability of the blockchain. So data is the base where I started my presentation. Now the credibility of the data, how I am going to achieve it? So blockchain is a technology which is giving me a almost foolproof mechanism whereby once the data is stored, I can be rest assured that nobody can change the data, and whatever decision I will be taking on that data, whatever processing I would be doing on that data, that would be actually perfect, and there cannot be any compromise in that. See, in RDBMS, I can go and fire a query, and today I can change the data of even 2011 as an example. So then it's not a reliable medium for the data. See, there may be applications where it is required. That's fine. We are not saying that why they are changing the data. But the data which we are really expecting that it should not change, we should have such data. Let me take some example of the use case. Let's say Aadhaar as an identity we are talking about. Now my whole Aadhaar data, if I store into the blockchain, then I'm 100% sure that, I'm sorry. I am 100% sure that whatever my Aadhaar ID is there, that is with me only, and nobody else can take the Aadhaar ID. The further mechanism with the blockchain is to interact with the blockchain or to transact with the blockchain environment. I have to use my digital signature. So my private key, public key technology comes in picture, and my identity is getting established through my private key and the public key. And these are some of the key features of this particular technology through which it is becoming very vibrant, it is becoming very important, and everybody is trying to explore that technology for their own purpose. And we will see some of the use cases depending on the whatever amount of the time it permits to me for this session. We will see some of the use cases through which you will be able to connect that how differently people are using the blockchain how that would not have become possible into the current RDBMS oriented world. Possibly we will be able to connect. So is this answer the question?
Yes, sir. And sir, one more question from participant is, why exchange rate is so high in cryptocurrency?
Okay, I will ask. I'll ask the question. See, if I go to, ultimately I have T only. Let's say I'm giving the example of T. I can get a T at 10 rupees or let's say 20 rupees. If I go to 5-star, will I get a 10 rupees or 20 rupees?
No.
They are charging maybe 200 rupees, 400 rupees, 500 rupees. Quantity is almost same. So why there is a change?
Because of quality and services they provide.
Yes. So that's what is the shift which blockchain offers, that the current technology or the current ecosystem of the technology which is not offering, that's what they are offering. That is one. Number two, the compared to the banking transactions or the normal financial transactions or the activities which are being carried out, especially in particular the cryptocurrency, though the numbers are in terms of the lakhs and it may touch millions very soon. But here in terms of the my real world or the banking transactions, the transactions are maybe 10 times more, 100 times more. So the overall cost is getting distributed into that number of the that number of the people or the that number of the transactions. And the number of people who are blockchain are relatively into the very premium segment or into the very niche segment. So the common people are not really using. So blockchain is for a different business. And according to the need of the business, so it is also indirectly saying that this is not for the my traditional commercial low value transaction, unless your transaction value is very, very high and you are going to derive a much higher value from the blockchain as a technology, then only you should enter for that use case. Otherwise, you should not enter for the use case. That is also a message out of this.
Yes, sir, got it. You can proceed.
Okay. As you see that there are different people, different companies, everybody's coming up the blockchain, and every cryptocurrency is developed into the different technology. So backbone technology is a very discrete one. It is in very silos and everybody has developed on their own. So now the interoperability of the different blockchain has become the important point. Or one can say that it can become a limitation if we really don't achieve that or address that. See, if I have stored certain data in MS SQL Server, which is from Microsoft, and I have stored certain data into the Oracle, and if I really want to migrate the data or transact the data from MS SQL Server to Oracle, or Oracle to the MySQL, or MySQL to the MS SQL Server, those compatibility are really available. Because in those days, the certain standards have been implemented, and as a result, the compatibility has become possible. So same exercise right now is going on for the blockchain and DLT, that is distributed ledger technology. So there is a ISO is a body, International Organization for Standardization. So they have set up a committee, and this particular committee is taking care of the standardization. So they have set up a committee which is conceptualizing the certain terminology and standardization on that. What is the privacy and personally identity?